passion, purpose, possibilities. They're all right there. But sometimes we need a little push. And that's where SheSez comes in. Think of it as a master class taught by the world's most interesting women, sharing stories and ideas, because girlfriends help each other. This is SheSez with Linda Grasso. Hello and welcome to SheSez. Our guest today is Allison Samek, CEO of Fred Segal. If you're after cutting edge California style, Fred Segal is where you go to get it. From clothing to accessories to home decor, if you pick it up at one of their two locations, you are guaranteed to have a cool factor. Even if you've never been to the store, you've probably heard of it. The legendary retailer has been mentioned countless times in movies like Legally Blonde and TV shows like Entourage. Allison, or Allie, as I call you, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me today.
Well, thanks for making the time. So you have a pretty glamorous job. Is it all that?
It's pretty glamorous. It's a great job. It is a great job. Obviously, it's a job. So there's a lot of late nights. There's a million emails and responsibility and stress. But as far as jobs go, I feel pretty blessed and lucky.
How often do you actually, I'm sorry, we just got to get out of the way, all the women's stuff at first. How often do you find yourself or allow yourself to purchase something you see?
Oh, good question. Well, I go to the store. Our corporate office isn't in the store. It's in Century City. And so I try to make myself present at the store at least once a week. And I would say I buy something there almost every time I go. It's hard. We get new stuff in every day. And so it's really hard to resist.
You actually came on my radar because I saw you speak at a women's event. What was the name of that fantastic group?
It was the XX Project.
Yeah, I love that group.
They're wonderful.
All about female empowerment, exactly. And sharing with stories, much of what I'm about it with SheSez. And I remember you kind of opened your opening remarks where you said something like, a woman always remembers their very first purchase at Fred Segal.
We actually say that anybody who walks in the store remembers their first experience at Fred Segal because it's one of three things. They either remember who they saw there, they remember what they bought there, or they remember how they felt when they were there. So we always hear stories that go something like, oh, when I was 9 and my mom took me to Fred Segal for the first time, I saw Prince, or I saw Michael Jackson, I saw somebody. Or, oh, I remember when I was 16 and I got my first job, I bought a white shirt. And they remember this 20 or 30 years later, which I don't think happens with most retailers. I think it's a unique experience. And something that Fred Segal and probably only us in LA can kind of share and spread that.
And of course, when I met you, I blurted out my first Fred Segal purchase.
And you remember it, right?
Oh, my gosh, I completely do. Because
What was it?
Well, I'll tell you, I told you that night. It was a pair of black, we'd gone out to dinner with my husband's boss and his wife, and she was impossibly chic. She still is. And she was wearing a pair of black capri pants.
You did tell me this.
And
I remember this.
And they were just, the way they were cut was super sophisticated for the time. And I went out and I bought them, and I wore them, I swear to God, for years and years until my husband finally said to me, you do know those are splitting in the seam down the butt. And I'm like, what? And even then, I didn't throw them out. I kept them and wore them for another season.
Yeah. Yeah, we hear that over and over. And I think those stories are so fun to hear because everybody who grew up in LA or visited LA has a Fred Segal story. And that, so getting to kind of run a brand that has that experience behind it and lore behind it has been really a thrill.
So what really fascinated me about your story was that you're a smart woman. You were smart right off the bat. Where did you go to college?
I went to Washington University in St. Louis for undergrad.
And then you got an MBA.
I got an MBA at Stanford 3 years after that.
And you were smart. And you immediately embarked on this, you know, sort of career. You working at companies like, you were first at Deloitte.
Correct.
And then you went to eBay where you worked on their fashion division.
Right.
And you were heavily vested in that. You know, you were, correct me if I'm wrong, but you seemed to be kind of climbing the ladder.
I definitely always had career goals, and I was always looking, I was motivated. I was definitely motivated, and I always knew what I wanted to do, and I knew the industry I wanted to be in, and so I was pretty focused and motivated even at a pretty young age as an undergrad.
And where did that come from?
Probably my Jewish overbearing mom and dad. You know, my parents were really strict. They were really determined. They made me determined, like, they just set a very high expectation, which I think was a good thing. And I remember my dad has this like famous line, you know, you can teach a man to fish. If you, well, how does the line go? If you give a man a fish,
You can't teach a man to fish.
Basically, it's basically like teach a man to fish and he'll have food for the rest of his life.
Oh,
and when I graduated college, my dad gave me a fishing pole and was basically like, we've sent you to college and now you're on your own. You know how to fish and go get a job. And they were really, they kind of put me on this path of you're on your own. We're here to support you emotionally. We, of course, will do that, but go figure it out. And I think that little kick to go live on your own, we're not paying your rent, you know, you got to get a job and you got to go forward at 18 years old was a good kick in the pants.
Yeah, that's just such a smart way to parent. I'm at that stage now where I need to be booting some butts out.
Well, I think sometimes that times seem to have changed. It does seem like that's not the norm anymore. I think a lot of kids come back and live at home because just the financial situation alone and the job market is different now. But it wasn't an option for me. And so
there's still a lot of coddling that goes on.
There probably is.
And by the way, I'm as guilty as the next mom. And that probably is unnecessary and not useful for a young man or a young woman.
Right.
Okay, so you go from eBay to Ron Herman, and Ron Herman is a men's and women's retailer,
right.
High end, also SoCal cool, cutting edge. Remember my first purchase there too, but we won't talk about that one. And you were there 10 years.
Yeah, almost 12, 11 and a half years.
Wow.
A little over 11 years.
Let's talk about that. What was that experience like for you and what were you doing at Ron Herman?
Well, it was great. That was the job I had in my 30s. I started there at 29 and I left there at 40. So just about a few months before my 40th birthday. I had been working at eBay, running the clothing, shoes, and accessories marketing business there. And I left eBay because my husband got a job down in Los Angeles and had been doing the long distance thing for a while. And we wanted to live in the same city. We had just gotten married. And I happened to be sitting, was looking for a job, and my cousin happened to be Ron Herman's lawyer. And he invited me to an event that one of the lawyers was being honored at, and Ron was there, and we ended up sitting next to each other and chatting, and I took the job there to go open a website for him. He didn't have a website. So I opened up ronherman.com, and this is back in 2004, and it was a great website. It did really well right off the bat. I think Ron was really pleased, and I was really pleased. And then about a year later, I got pregnant with my first son, Gabe, and when I came back, the job had sort of shifted while I was on maternity leave. I think it was, I don't think Ron had ever really had an employee be out for a little while. And I think that was a little bit of a struggle for him. And so when I came back, the job was sort of no longer there, which was challenging. And they put me into a job in operations, working for the CFO. And it turned out, at the time, I was really upset. This is a long time ago. But it actually turned out to be the best thing ever for my career because it was actually a job that I was much better suited in. I actually really loved it. And the CFO was a fantastic guy, and he was there for like another 6 or 7 years. I worked for him, and I just sort of worked and took on more responsibility and more responsibility in operations. And then when he left, I was offered his position to run everything he was working on and continue on the operations too. And I did that for another 4 years or so after that. And it was definitely that experience at that job that taught me 80% of what I need to know in this job. Obviously, the foundation and my career is always set in the earlier pieces of my career, but the on-the-job retail learning was in that job. So that was very, very, very helpful. And I'm internally grateful for that.
So what year did you have your second son?
So my second son, I had my first one when I was 30. That was 2006. And the second one came 3 years later in 2009. And actually, when I had my second son, it was really fortunate timing in some ways because he was born, I think the month or month after the market crashed, the absolute bottom of the market with the recession. And obviously being a retailer, it was impacting it. Ron Herman was impacted. And I proposed to him as a way to save money, could I come back part-time? And could I come back 3 days a week? And he totally jumped at that and I jumped at it. And we did that for the next 6 years. And I was working 3 days a week in the office and 2 days a week from home. And it was, and the 2 days a week from home, I took a pay cut, and so it wasn't full time from home, but I was always responsive to emails and phone calls and things like that.
I got to tell you, I found the leap of having one child to the second enormous. I don't know, one was so easy, the nanny, the food and all that, and then two was just much more labor intensive.
Yeah, for me, it was the opposite.
You're
because
kidding.
My first son was really hard. He had all sorts of sensory problems, and he was just a really hard baby. So when he was awake, he was crying. And honestly, I couldn't wait to get back to work because I was just so overwhelmed by the crying all the time. And the second son turned out to be a really easy baby, happy all the time and smiley. And I just kind of, it was like not that much more work. But having the two, just to be able to balance the schedules was really, really hard. And I've always had really good help and support. But the part-time offer was really helpful. And it honestly made the total difference for me. And it worked out really well for both of us. I think it was a mutually beneficial schedule.
So then there came a time when there was another shift. You were offered something and you had sort of the gumption to say no. Tell us about that transition.
Well, there was a little bit of a lag between there. So I, the job, I'd been in the same job for almost 11 years at that point, and 10 if you took off the web piece from that I did the first year. And I, the job was becoming a little routine for me. It was really interesting, and I have nothing but positive things to say about that experience. But in 11 years in the same job, it was a long time. Mm-hmm. And my kids were getting older, and I was starting to feel some guilt. And I was really feeling like I needed to be with them more. And my husband's career had gotten really successful, and we sort of made the decision that, like, is this worth it? Like, you know, I did take a reduction in pay, so I wasn't making a ton of money. And I was paying a lot for help to help when I wasn't there. And there's always that cost-benefit analysis. And I wasn't, I always liked going to work, but I didn't have like a massive passion for it at that point. I really wanted just to take some time off with the kids. And so I gave my notice, and I gave a month notice, and we left on really good terms, and it was great. And I left on May 1st of 2016. And I told myself that I wasn't even going to think about what I was going to do for at least a month or two. But by September 1st, I wanted to have something going on. And I actually had this like alternative business idea I wanted to do. I wanted to buy clothing and products downtown wholesale and retail them out of my house and out of my, and start an online business. And I wanted to do it with a friend and something not massively huge. I didn't have grand expectations for what I wanted to do.
You just wanted something to call your own.
I wanted my own kind of fun thing.
Yeah.
And over the course of like June and July, my girlfriend and I met. We went downtown a few times. We bought the business name. You know, we actually bought a website name, and we started actually doing this. And we both said September 1st, we're going to start full time. And around July 1st or July 15th, I went to the beach and I ran into a buddy of mine from Stanford. And I said, oh, how are you? How's it going? And he'd been running a different company. And he said to me, I actually just took a new job a month ago at CAA in their investment arm, which is called Evolution Media. And we own Fred Segal. And I need help. Like, are you willing? Would you come and help us and look at our model and make sure like we're doing things right? And, you know, we don't have a CEO right now, and we just really could use some help. They had a president who's still there, who's fantastic. But they were looking for some help. And I literally said to him, I said, no, I'm sorry. No, thank you. Like, I'll help you with whatever I can. Just talking to you, chatting with you on the beach, but like not interested at all. It was just like too close to my old job. It was too close to home. And I was not even remotely in that area of like going to a corporate company and doing their model for them. Like,
that's the kind of thing where you give up all your freedom.
I was not even remotely interested. Zero interest. And
did what was your husband's counsel on that? Was there or any girlfriends, anyone, you know, saying, always, you know, Allie, think about this?
Well, you know, it was presented as a very much like, hey, would you just come and talk to us? It was actually not about, do you want a CEO job? It was literally, will you help us come work on this model with us and make sure what we've laid out here is how we're modeling the business for the future is correct. And it was literally just a, will you come consult and talk to us about this? And I said, no, like I wasn't really interested in it. It wasn't interesting to me. And my husband's job has always been like, do what you want. Like, I want you to be happy, but I also want you to be, you know, aware of like good opportunities. And actually he was the one who later, and we can get into this, told me to take the job. But, so I said no. And I, and about 2 weeks later, he called me again and said, listen, I really do need your help. Like, would you ever mind coming in and, you know, we can pay you for your hours that you spend on it, but just take a look at the model. And I said to him, listen, like, you're a buddy of mine from, he's a close friend of mine from business school. And I was like, you don't need to pay me. Like, just send me the model. I'll take a look at it and I'll let you know. So I did that and met with them and had some comments. And I think sort of as I was talking to them, maybe a little bit of a light went off of somebody who was like, this girl has a lot of experience in exactly what we're doing, knows what she's talking about. Like, can we get her to help some more? So they asked me, you know, would you come back in and do another couple hours with us? And I said no again. And then, you know, he called me again and he said, we'll pay you, you know, and set whatever hourly rate you want. And so then I was sort of like, well, it's the summertime. Like, I could do a 5 hour a week consulting gig. That's a good deal. And anyway, the short version of the story is we met a few more times over the course of the summer, and it developed from, you know, we want you to kind of look at the model, to what are your thoughts on this and the strategy, to would you ever consider a job? And P.S., like, what about the CEO position? And again, when that was presented, it wasn't even like a thought. My initial reaction was, I could never do that. Like, one, I think I had some imposter syndrome where I was like, I couldn't handle that job. I wouldn't even be good at that job. You don't want me for that job. Like, you think I know what I'm talking about, but I actually don't, you know? And because I think a lot of women have
that. Oh my gosh. Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. I grapple with that too. It's crazy. Right. A lot of women talk about having the imposter
syndrome. I think that was my first idea. I'm going to be discovered. Like, there's no way that, like, they really, that I could do that job.
Right. And if you take it, they're going to discover you're a fraud.
Right. Yeah. And we just continued a long series of talks, and then we started negotiating. And I was very fortunate because the company was based walking distance to my house. I live in Beverly Hills, and it was in Century City. So that worked lifestyle-wise. But I did know that this is like a full-time job. And never, ever, when I left my job at Ron Herman, did I think I would ever go work somewhere full-time. If you had said to me, like, I'll pay you any amount of money, would you do it? I would have said no. Like, there was no thought that I would ever go back full-time in a really grinding job. And, but, you know, my husband sort of had the best outlook on it, which was like, well, why not? Like, why would you not try it? Like, if you absolutely hate it in a year or two, and I did give them a 2-year commitment at the minimum. I said, listen, I would never take something that I didn't think I could actually focus on. And I felt like that was fair. But if you hate it, you can always do something else later, you know? But he said to me, he's like, do you want to leave your career forever with what you've done? Are you going to be able to sleep at night and be like, where I left off is the best I could do? And it was the most I could achieve. And that really weighed on me. And the answer to that was no. Like, I did not reach my potential in that job.
So you had that, and you had the realization, the acceptance that you needed a little something more than being a stay-at-home mom.
I did. And you know, I'd only been a stay-at-home mom for 4 months at this point, or 5 months. By the time I took the job and we negotiated everything, all the details, it was 6 months to the day that I started. So I had a 6-month break. And I will tell you, that break was really, really needed. It was wonderful. I was able to work out. I was able to, like, get my health back. I was able to spend time with the kids. It was over a summer. And so I really got to see them. And I had kept the help. So there was, like, no stress. I got to do the fun things with them. Without worrying about, like, all the stresses that go along with being a full-time mom, because it is such a stressful job too. And it was like an ideal dream situation. But I was noticing that every time they would send me an email about Fred Segal just to talk about it, or a question about it, I was, like, really interested in doing the emails. I was like, oh, wait, hold on, I got to go do this, you know? And
you were excited.
Yeah, I was excited. And the opportunity for growth there, and the opportunity to lead something that has a huge, huge potential, was so exciting to me. To be part of something that has amazing history, but also a huge opportunity for the future.
What was it like when you told the boys that you were going back to work full time?
You know, honestly, they were totally fine with it. They were completely excited. I think they were old enough to totally get it. And I think my older one was excited that, like, was still in the, like, well, this is more money for me. Like, you know, I get to get, you know,
perks,
more money, perks, you know.
Right. The typical LA kid thinks about perks.
Yeah, of course. Typical LA kid. And the younger one, I think, had a little bit harder time with it. But honestly, like, they were so used their whole life. They knew mom worked. So, and they've seen mom work, and they've seen dad work. And so they were used to it. And I had always said when I was home that summer, like, starting in September, I'm going to start doing something else again anyway. So it was easy for them. That was fine. It's become more challenging as the jobs evolved. And I've been there about a year and a half now. But their initial reaction was totally fine.
So you've been there a year and a half. How are you juggling all the balls? What's fallen through the cracks?
Yeah. There have definitely been things that have fallen through the cracks. I have missed a couple things at school that I didn't even know were occurring. You know, like, there was a performance I didn't even know. And in general, I feel like I'm mostly able to get everything we need. And our team is amazing, and they're all flexible. And like I said, we have this incredible president, John Frierson, who is really supportive, and he'll cover for me. I'll cover for him when we have something going on at our kids' schools. What's fallen through the crack is that I don't get home till pretty late in the evening, and they've already done their homework. And so I'm not at all involved in the schoolwork, and that's hard for me because I'm a control freak. And mm-hmm. so in the past, I was able to do that and really monitor what they were doing and do that. And I've had to let that go.
And another thing, when we talked at this event, you sort of said you let go of is the fact that everything's going to be perfect.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the house is going to be perfect. The lunch is going to be perfectly made. You know, you're like doing the best you can, and you own it.
Well, I'll give you one example. So I've never been a huge cook. I mean, when I could outsource it, I did. But I always like made sure we had dinner on the table, whether my father-in-law, who's incredibly generous, would bring over dinner because he loves to cook, or my au pair would prepare a dinner. We used Blue Apron, which is a great like prep tool. I always made sure like dinner was on the table, and we were, if not eating together because the kids had activities, like it was there. And honestly, like this home cooked dinner thing is the first thing that went, which I definitely had guilt over, but like they are well fed. My kids are not starving, but like I know I have friends who are stay-at-home moms who cook like a delicious dinner for their family every night. And like, that's just not the case in my house. And I hope my kids don't look back 20 years from now and say like, mom didn't cook dinner, but I just can't cook dinner. Like I outsourced people cooking dinner, but it's not mom cooking dinner. And that's something that like, I just had to acknowledge is not going to happen.
Best case scenario, you encourage them to learn to cook.
You know, it's true. And then what I'd said to myself is, well, on the weekends, like I've never loved cooking. And so we use the time on the weekends, like we go out to dinner on Saturday nights. And I think if I did love cooking, it would be a time where I could cook on the weekends. But to me, it was always like a task and a chore. And that was the first one that I was like, I'm going to outsource this and I'm not going to feel guilty about it.
Well, even just coming up with solutions like using Blue Apron.
Right.
I mean, I find that part of the whole cooking dinner thing, which, by the way, I'm a slave to as well. And it's self-inflicted. I mean, I love to cook. And
right. I think if you love to cook, it's different.
I do, but it still isn't different because right. I have limited time.
Right.
But I started that whole, like my mom's always said, why do you feel like you need to cook dinner every night? Why? I just did. I don't know. That was something that I started. And now that I'm pulling back because I'm a little busier in life, everyone else is going, where's the dinner?
Right.
Where's the dinner?
Exactly.
But getting back to your solution, which I think is really creative, services like Blue Apron and Chef,
yeah.
C-H-E-F apostrophe D, they deliver the food. It's all chopped. So you don't have to right. grocery shop. You don't have to do all the prep work.
Right.
They come with like a recipe and everything's chopped and prepared and it's pretty fresh and good.
No, it's good. I mean, listen, honestly, what's more important is sitting down to eat it. And that has gone, and I will say that now that my kids are older, they have sports and they have things going on. And we're not able to do the dinner, but not because of me. I'm home in time for dinner almost every night. It's that they have activities now.
And I want to talk about that because you're at a point where, you know, you could have dialed it back and stayed dialed in and been a stay-home mom. And I mean, do you ever think about, wow, I'm so glad I have this now? And I share this because I remember a certain time in life when I had quit and my kids were in junior high and getting home from school and sports so late, it was leaving me with a huge gap. And
yeah.
I mean, I was one of those women where I was like, okay, it's 5 o'clock. Is it too, you know, not to say that I was an alcoholic, but you know, you're so bored. I'm like, can I have a glass of wine now?
Right.
Because it was just like nothing was going on. My husband still would get home at 8 after his job. And it's this chunk of time. And if you're not working, that sort of, you know, time when you're used to picking up the kids and bringing them home and doing homework with them or going to their sporting events and, you know, that sort of 3 to 7 o'clock window, that's a hideous time.
Well, it seems like my friends who are stay-at-home moms are incredibly busy 3 to 7, mostly driving and mostly shuttling, which I don't enjoy that much.
But not when they get older and they drive themselves.
That's a good point.
And when my kids were 16 and they were driving,
then you were like, what am I doing now?
Yeah. I mean, I still went to some of their games, but it wasn't as rewarding for me as, I mean, it was and it wasn't. Like
right.
they didn't like run out and hug me.
No.
And be like, oh, you're here. Great. And they'd snort at me and walk by.
When I take my kids to practice, like I'm taking one tonight. And honestly, like we drive, I like the drive because we get to chit chat on the drive sometimes when he's in the mood to talk. And then when we get there, like he has no interest in me being there. In fact, I think he would prefer if I sat in the car. But
that is exactly how I felt.
But and then we have the drive home. And I do think that those drive times are important. And one of the things that I am constantly talking to my husband about is that we need to drive the kids to school every morning because we don't pick up because we're both working. And so one of us takes the kids to school each morning. They go to two different schools and we rotate. And even though they might not want to talk to us in the car on the way there, they might say zero words. Having them remember that mom drove them to school or dad drove them to school, if you ask him, he says, mom takes me to school. Like, he gets it. And so we try to carve out, like, those periods of time because we don't always get dinner anymore where it's where they just have that, like, attachment to, like, mom and dad takes me to do this. And my husband cooks breakfast every Sunday morning now. And they gripe about it. They don't like what he cooks or whatever. But, like, at least, like, they'll have that memory of, like, a tradition that dad cooks breakfast on Sundays. Mom takes me to school every day. Mom does that. You know, and I think that those are really important, too.
Wow, it seems like you've really carved a wonderful situation out for yourself.
It's working for
it's
now.
It's working.
Like, that's how I think I said that at the event. Like,
you did.
We assess this all the time, and it is working now. And when it stops working, we're going to have to make adjustments. And, you know, it's always an adjustment of, like, which kid needs what out of mom and dad right now, and how can we best accommodate that?
How much, how challenging is your job as CEO of Fred Segal, and how do you manage the stress, if there is stress?
So it's challenging in the sense that I'm always on. So I don't think there's a day in the last year and a half where I haven't checked email every day, like, or maybe even multiple times a day, every hour. Like, it's constantly attached to me. Like, I haven't had a vacation since I've started where I haven't been on the phone checking email or talking to people. But the hours in the office are completely manageable. I drop the kids off at school and I go to work, and then I usually leave around 6:15. And like I said, my office is 3 minutes from my house. So in LA, it's a miracle, and I'm home 10 minutes later. And then I'll get the kids ready, we'll go to dinner, and then I'll check email again before bed. But email to me is enjoyable because it's just managing the business, and I like managing the business. So it's not a stress for me, and it's not something I have any sort of, like, negative feeling towards. I enjoy it because I think that the difference is that, like, I look forward to answering email. I look forward to the work. So I can't say it's stressful because there's pressures on the business in terms of financials.
Well, absolutely. And
but
I want to talk
work itself is nothing but enjoyable.
I want to talk about that a little bit because we do have a lot of, you know, women in their 20s and 30s who look at a job like yours. And I mean, right now you're primarily tasked with increasing the international licenses.
Correct.
Of Fred Segal so that they're Fred Segal boutiques across the world.
Correct.
Talk to me about that a little bit. Is that easy? Is that hard? And what are some of the inherent challenges in that as an executive?
I mean, I think the challenge is always keeping everybody focused on the task at hand, which is our licensing strategy, because we have this incredible flagship store on Sunset, and we need to really make that store incredible to sell the license around the world, because nobody wants to license a Fred Segal store if Fred Segal stores aren't incredible. So it's a constant balance of, like, how much time and energy does our team put into our store here versus into our licensing and stores around the world. Then it's setting the strategy for how do we grow this business internationally to meet the financial expectations of our investors. So that balance is challenging, and we work on that all the time.
So what about the fact that, like, I grew up, or I've been in LA for 20 years, so I'm totally familiar with Fred Segal. I get it 100%. And lots of other people do too, who are really hang on that sort of SoCal culture, which is so in demand, I guess, across the world. But How is the international sort of marketplace aware of the Fred Segal brand, and how do you communicate that for people who don't get it immediately like me?
They're more aware than I think we thought they were. So the last year and a half has really been an experiment in going out internationally to kind of shop the license around and shop the business. And John Frierson, our president, is mostly he's the person who runs that piece of the business. And I think what he's found is that the brand is very well known around the world, probably more well known than we had thought it would be in countries where we didn't think it would be. So in Turkey and in Greece, they're incredibly interested in bringing Fred Segal over there. In Taiwan, we're opening up a store this year, and we're going to be, you know, doing international expansion in multiple places in Asia where there's a lot of brand recognition. Then there's other places in the world where it is not. So in India is a country where they're very interested in bringing it, but they've acknowledged, like, it's not a hugely widely recognized brand yet here, but it will be. And I think American pop culture kind of transcends the world right now, and we are the quintessential American pop culture brand. So there's definitely more interest than we always knew there was interest, but there was extreme interest, which was really pleasant to find.
Allie, what should our listeners take away from your story? Tips, strategies, something we can think about after the podcast is over and perhaps apply it to our own lives. What can we learn from your journey?
Well, I guess I would just tell everybody, you know, don't worry about everything being perfect right now. If there's something you don't love, you have to kind of address what's going on and figure out, like, is it getting me something that I can use later? So I remember being at eBay, and I worked a ton there, you know, 70, 80 hours a week. It's a really intense culture. And this is back in the early 2000s, at really, like, the peak of the eBay business. And I remember hating the hours and being really stressed, but I knew that it was like for a bigger purpose. Like I knew it was a stepping stone for my career, and it was. And I also met some of the smartest people I've ever worked with at that job. And so I would say, like, always look at when you're in an experience, look at what is it getting for you? Is it leading me for something now or for the future? And if it's for neither, then I think it's probably time to kind of reexamine that. And like I said with the emails before, I was kind of thinking, you know, if I didn't love the actual work, none of this would be worth it. And so I think if you're out there and you're in a job and actually just responding to the emails or writing emails and doing the day-to-day job isn't enjoyable for you, it's not the right job. And you have to be passionate about the work itself or none of this works. It just doesn't work. And so I would say, like, find something that you're passionate about, because in the end, that really is what drives the happiness.
Allison Samek, thanks so much for joining us. I want to get off the air so you can tell me what I need to buy at Fred Segal this season. And I'm serious. Please don't go anywhere.
thanks so much for having me.
Thank you to all our listeners. You can follow along and on Instagram and Facebook and see who's coming up each Tuesday. We appreciate your time. Thank you so much.